55. Deviant form makes lustful play for Tripitaka Tang. Upright nature safeguards the untainted self. We were just telling you of the great sage Sun and Ju 8 rules, who were about to use magic to render those women immobile when they heard the shouts of Sha Monk and the howl of the wind. They turned quickly to look, only to discover that the Tang monk had vanished. "Who is it that has abducted master?" asked Pilgrim, and Sha Monk said, "It's a girl. She called up a cyclone and whizzed master away." When Pilgrim heard this, he leapt straight up to the edge of the clouds. Using his hand to shade his eyes, he peered all around and found a roiling mass of wind and dust hurtling toward the northwest. "Brothers," he shouted to them down below, "mount the clouds quickly to pursue master with me." 8 rules and Sha Monk tied the luggage to the horse, and with a whoosh they all shot up to midair and left. Those women of the state of Western Liang, ruler and subjects, were so terrified that they knelt on the ground, all crying. "So these are arhats who can ascend to heaven in broad daylight." Then the officials said to the queen, "Let not our ruler be frightened or vexed anymore. The royal brother of Tang has to be a Buddhist monk who has attained the way. Since none of us possesses true discernment, we could not recognize these Chinese men for what they are, and all our schemings have been wasted. Let our mistress ascend the carriage to go back to court." The queen herself became quite embarrassed, and as she went back to the capital with all her officials, "We shall leave them for the moment. We tell you instead about the great sage Sun with his 2 brothers, who trod on air and fog to give chase to that cyclone." In a little while, they came upon a tall mountain, where they saw the dust had died down and the wind subsided. Not knowing where the fiend had gone to, the 3 brothers lowered their clouds and began to search for the way. It was then that they saw on the side of the mountain a huge slab of stone, all shiny and green, that looked like a screen. The 3 of them led the horse to the back of the screen and discovered 2 stone doors, on which there was in large letters the following inscription: "Toxic Fo Mountain, Cave of the Lute." As he had always been rather stupid, 8 Rules immediately wanted to break down the doors with his rake, but he was quickly stopped by Pilgrim. "Don't be so hasty, brother," he said. "After we followed the cyclone here, we had to search for a while before we found these doors. We don't even know the long and short of the matter. Suppose this is the wrong door? Won't your action offend the owner? I think the 2 of you should look after the horse and wait in front of that stone screen. Let old monkey go inside to do some detection before we start anything." Greatly pleased by what he heard, Sha Monk said, "Very good. This is what I call caution in recklessness, composure in urgency." So, the 2 of them led the horse away. The great sage Sun, meanwhile, displayed his divine power. Making the magic sign with his fingers, he recited a spell and with one shake of his body changed into a bee, truly agile and light. Look at him. His thin wings go soft with wind. His waist in sunlight is trim. A mouth once sweetened by flowers. A tail that striped toads has tamed. What merit in honey making? How modest his home returning. A smart plan he now conceives. To soar past both doors and eaves. Crawling inside through a crack in the door, Pilgrim flew past the 2nd level door, and came upon a flower arbor in the middle of which sat a female fiend. Attending her on both sides were several young girls dressed in colored silk and with parted bangs on their foreheads. All of them appeared to be in a most pleasant mood, talking with great animation about something. Ever so lightly our pilgrim flew up there and alighted on the trellis of the arbor. As he cocked his ear to listen, he saw 2 other girls with disheveled hair walking up to the arbor, each holding a plate of steaming hot pastries. "Madam," they said, "on this plate are buns stuffed with human flesh, and on the other buns stuffed with red bean paste. Little ones," said the female fiend with a giggle, "help the royal brother of Tang to come out." The girls dressed in colored silk went to one of the rear chambers and led the Tang monk out by his hands. The master's face, however, had turned yellow and his lips white. His eyes were red and brimming with tears. Master has been poisoned, sighed Pilgrim to himself. The fiend walked out of the arbor and extended her dainty, spring onion-like fingers to catch hold of the elder, saying, "Relax, royal brother. Though our place here is not like the palace of the Western Liang state of women, and cannot compare with their wealth and luxury, it is actually less hectic and more comfortable. You will find it perfect for chanting the name of Buddha and reading scriptures. I'll be your companion on the way, and we'll enjoy a harmonious union until old age." Tripitaka would not utter a word. "Stop worrying," said the fiend again. "I know that you didn't eat much when you attended the banquet in the state of women. Here are two kinds of flour goods, meat and vegetarian, and you may take whatever you want, just to calm your fear." Tripitaka thought to himself, "I can remain silent and refuse to eat anything, but this fiend is not like the queen. The queen, after all, is a human being whose action is governed by propriety. This fiend is a monster spirit most capable of hurting me. What shall I do? I wonder if my three disciples know that I am held in custody here. If she does harm me because of my stubbornness, wouldn't I have thrown away my life?" As he questioned his mind with mind like that, he had no alternative but to force himself to open his mouth. "What's the meat made of, and what's the vegetarian made of?" he asked. The fiend said, "The meat bun has human flesh stuffing, while the vegetarian has red bean paste stuffing. This poor monk," said Tripitaka, "keeps a vegetarian diet." "Girls," said the female fiend, giggling, "bring us some hot tea so that the elder of your household can eat the vegetarian buns." One of the girls brought out a cup of fragrant tea and placed it in front of the elder. Picking up a vegetarian bun, the fiend broke it in half and handed the pieces to Tripitaka, who in turn took a meat bun and presented it whole to the fiend. "Royal brother," asked the fiend, laughing, "why didn't you break it first before you handed it to me?" Tripitaka pressed his palms together before he replied, "As someone who has left the family, I dare not break open food made with meat. If you, as someone who has left the family, dare not break open food made with meat," said the fiend, "how is it that you were willing to eat water pudding the other day at the child and mother stream? Having done that, do you still insist on eating red bean paste stuffing today?" Tripitaka replied, "At high tide a boat leaves quickly. In sand traps a horse trots slowly. Pilgrim on the trellis heard everything." Fearing that such banter might confound the real nature of his master, he could no longer contain himself. He revealed his true form at once and whipped out his iron rod. "Cursed beast," he shouted, "you're so unruly." When the female fiend saw him, she blew out immediately from her mouth a ray of misty light to cover up the entire arbor. "Little ones," she cried, "take away the royal brother." Picking up a steel trident, she leapt out of the arbor and yelled, "Lawless simian rascal, how dare you sneak into my house and play peeping Tom? Don't run away. Have a taste of your mama's trident." Using the iron rod to parry her blows, the great sage fought back as he retreated. The two of them fought their way out of the cave. Eight rules and Sha Monk were waiting in front of the stone screen. When they saw the combatants emerging, Eight Rules hurriedly pulled the white horse out of the way, saying, "Sha Monk, you guard the horse and the luggage. Let old hog go and help with the fight." "Dear idiot." Lifting high the rake with both his hands, he rushed forward and shouted, "Elder brother, stay back. Let me beat up this bitch." When the fiend saw Eight Rules approaching, she summoned up some more of her abilities. With one snort, fire spurted out from her nostrils as smoke licked out from her mouth. She shook her body once and there were now three tridents dancing and thrusting in the air, wielded by who knows how many hands. As she charged like a cyclone into the fray, she was met by Pilgrim and Eight Rules on both sides. "Sun Wukong," cried the fiend, "you really have no judgment. I recognize you, but you can't recognize me. But even your Buddha Tathagata at the Thunderclap Monastery is afraid of me. Two clumsy oafs like you, you think you'll get anywhere? Come on up, both of you, and I'll give each of you a beating. How was this battle? You ask. The female fiend's power expanded. The monkey king's vigor increased. The heavenly reed's marshal, striving for merit, wielded wildly his rake to show his vim. That one with many hands and fast tridents the misty light encircled. From these two, impulsive, with strong weapons, foggy air rose up. The fiend wished only to seek a mate. The monk refused to leak his primal sperm. Yin and Yang at odds would do battle now. Each flaunting its might in this bitter strife. Quiet Yin, to nourish being, quickened in lust. Tranquil Yang purged desires to guard its health. To these two parties thus came discord. A contest was waged by trident, rake, and rod. This one's rod was strong. The rake, more potent. But the fiend's trident met them blow for blow. Three unyielding ones before mount toxic foe. Two ruthless sides outside cave of the loot. That one was pleased to seize the Tang monk for her spouse. These two with the elder resolved to seek true writ. To do battle they stirred up heaven and earth. And fought till sun and moon darkened and planets moved. The three of them fought for a long time and no decision was reached.